The man-child and the woman in the wilderness. The Lord is moving by His Spirit to bring about the fulfillment of that which is recorded in His Word. A man-child shall be born and caught up to the throne of God, Revelation 12:5. A woman is shown as clothed with the sun and the moon is under her feet, and a crown of stars is on her head. The Lord will bring together into one, a glorious church which shall be clothed with spiritual power, and with all that is of the soul, or self-life, put in subjection under her feet. She will function in the fullness of His covenant which is shown by the crown of stars on her head. That has its archetype in heaven, even a glorious church. When this church begins to function in the fullness of divine power, having been conformed in all things to that divine way and order set forth in God's word, then out of the womb of that church will come forth that which is described as a man-child. This man-child represents that mature and perfected group or company which shall come forth to minister in power in these last days. The man is a type and picture of the spirit which indwells the physical body, and the woman is a type and picture of the soul which envelops the spirit and interpenetrates the physical body. As Eve was to be in subjection to Adam, so is the soul which is the seed of desire and emotion to be subject to the indwelling spirit which is begotten of God. As the woman represents the glorious church, so does this portray that state or condition among God's people who have not yet come to maturity. Though the woman is shown to have the moon under her feet, the moon being also a symbol of the soul, she is still reflecting from that spiritual power in which she is clothed, the soulish or moon state of imperfection and immaturity. Glorious, yes, but not fully perfected. Thus we have the double witness of her still somewhat soulish condition by the fact that the moon of the soul is still in the picture, and by the fact that she is represented as a woman, which is also a type of the soul. You can now understand why that which comes forth from the woman is pictured as a man-child. It shows that the group or company which comes forth has come into that minimum of perfection or fullness which the Lord requires. And is the man as a type of the indwelling spirit which is to rule the house or home of the physical body, so does the man-child represent that maturity and fullness which is necessary to come forth in power in that ministry ordained for these last days. We also read that the man-child is caught up to the throne of God, Revelation 12:5. A throne is symbolic of power and authority. Those in the man-child company will be vested with power to do a mighty work for the Lord in these last days. Now I will show you a mystery not readily seen by those who would understand God's purposes for this company. The man-child company, being the firstborn of that which will come forth in power, is to be divided even as the firstfruits are divided into the sheaf which is cut and taken out of the harvest field, and the firstfruits which are left in the earth to act as a ferment of truth and righteousness until the work of the harvest time is complete. The man-child shall be caught up to power and authority in two distinct companies. First, there will be those of the first fruits who will be translated and caught up into the heavenlies to receive a commission to function in power in the realms beyond the veil. These shall be the 144,000 of Revelation 14:1. They will no longer be functioning in physical bodies, but in glorified bodies, and they will minister during the tribulation from the vantage of the heavenly realm, Mount Zion, which is a type of the heavenly and true spiritual kingdom of Christ. They will be working with that other portion of the man-child which is left on earth and which will be caught up to a position of power and authority and commissioned to do a work on the earth while yet in their physical bodies. This is the second fulfillment of the man-child being caught up to the throne of God. For both groups it is a catching up, but one to the heavenly and the other to the earthly authority and power. This is portrayed in the scripture by the man-child being caught up to the throne of God. Then, the dragon makes war with the remnant or remainder of the seed or offspring of the woman, Revelation 12:17. This remnant is that portion of the man-child company which is left on the earth to go forth in power in the last days, and they will be helped by the other portion or group which has been caught up to the heavenlies. Those in the heavenlies will have the power to appear and to speak to those who are yet on the earth. And they will be able to give them that protection and guidance which they will need in that day. This is portrayed by the fact that a double portion was given to the firstborn, Deuteronomy 21:17. The Lord will also have a double portion company in these last days. This double portion is symbolized by the heavenly and the earthly. One portion of the firstborn man-child will be in the heavenlies operating in power in that realm, and the other portion of the man-child will operate in the earthly realm in that ministry which will be committed to them. More on the man-child. Shall I not divide, says the Lord? Shall I not divide and conquer? Shall I not take that which I have prepared and deploy it to my advantage, that I might defeat the enemy and gain a great victory in this day? Shall I not use my forces in a way that will bring the enemy into subjection and destroy his works? And what are his works, says the Lord? Are they not death and destruction, sorrow and confusion, even the workings of chaos in the earth? And shall I not begin to destroy his works by overcoming the primary effect of sin, even death? For in the clutches of death has he held his victims since the beginning of sin. And none has overcome save that one who rose victoriously, even the Lord of glory. And shall I not now put into operation that which I have purposed? What is it, says the Lord? Is it not even this, that the man-child which I am preparing in the bosom of the woman shall come forth to victorious life and no longer be subject to death? For even as Jesus came forth from the bosom of the woman Israel, and was eventually caught up to the throne of his God, so shall I bring forth a company of overcomers who shall be caught up to my throne and invested with power to overcome the enemy. And even as Jesus rose to die no more, so shall this man-child company enter into deathless life to begin the destruction of the enemy's works. And now consider further what I would show you about this man-child company. It is even a mystery hid but is now to be revealed. Shall not this man-child be divided into two companies even as Elijah and Elisha were divided? And shall not one company be caught up into the heavenly realm to receive glorified life, and shall not the other company be left behind as was Elisha to enter into deathless life in the physical? For this is a pattern which I have set in my word, that there shall be a dividing and deploying of my forces, to the end that I may destroy all the workings of the enemy. The first division will be that of the man-child from the woman. This will be a division between those who are in my glorious church but who will remain in mortal flesh, and those who are born out of that church into immortality. There shall be a further division in that which is born, in that some shall be caught up to the heavenly realm and some shall be left on earth. Some shall be in glorified bodies and some shall be in immortal physical bodies. Those who are left on earth to function in immortal physical bodies are referred to in Revelation chapter 12 as the remnant, or remainder, of her seed. Revelation 12:17. They are the ones who remain after the main body of the man-child is taken. They will be with the woman, or glorious church in the wilderness of tribulation, but they shall be separate in that they will have entered into immortality in human flesh and will no longer be subject to death. They will be the manifest sons of that day even as Jesus was a manifested son in his day. And did not the Lord Jesus portray in himself the pattern for the end-time manifested sons by the two kinds of life which he lived? First he entered into immortality in human flesh and wrought mighty signs and wonders, even the power of the one who has received the fullness of the Father. So shall my manifested sons who are still on the earth wield the powers of their God in that day. Secondly, Jesus entered into glorified life after he was raised from the dead. Even so shall those of the man-child company who are taken enter into the powers of the glorified life and minister on the earth during the tribulation as Jesus ministered for 40 days after his resurrection. Thus shall the enemy's grip begin to be broken when my manifested ones enter into the realm where death no longer has dominion over them, whether in the earthly or in the heavenly sphere. And now consider further the mystery of the woman and the man-child. The woman represents my glorious church which will be functioning in divine power during the time of the tribulation. She will have come into the fullness of spiritual ministry and witness, symbolized by her being clothed with the sun, Revelation 12:1. Also with the moon under her feet, she has overcome the soulish realm of human desire and emotion, and as she is crowned with a crown of 12 stars, so is she functioning in the fullness of new covenant power and authority. But she is still in the realm of limitation because she has not yet been caught up to the throne and invested with that power which comes only to those who are no longer subject to death. She has not yet overcome sufficiently to be in the realm of the manifested sons. For the manifested sons or man-child company have overcome to the extent that death has been abolished for them, and whether in the heavenly or earthly they are no longer subject to its powers, neither the limitations of its domain. They are functioning in a realm which is beyond that of ordinary mortals. Now consider that which I require of you, that you may be in my glorious church in this day, and that you might be accounted worthy to be among those who will be filled with the fullness of their God in the days of tribulation impending. And I would have you consider further the price that must be paid in total commitment to me, which is the sacrifice necessary for those who would become the manifested sons of that day. For surely the day is coming shortly, and only those who have made a total commitment will have a part in the ministry which will bring liberation and salvation to multitudes in the days ahead. So consider, my people, that glory which is waiting those who are willing to pay the price in laying down their lives completely on the altar is a living sacrifice to me. Even so shall they receive a glory which is beyond compare, and a joy in service which few are able to comprehend. For I will have a people who will show forth my glory in these last days, says the Lord. Now consider further the mystery of Elijah and Elisha as a type of the manifested sons. The two are one, yet divided for the fulfillment of my purpose. First there shall be a division of the beginning of the tribulation, when the man-child or manifested sons shall be divided into those like Elijah who shall be taken, and those like Elisha who shall be left. And those who are left, like Elisha, shall have a double portion of power, for they will no longer be subject to death. This is shown by the fact that Elisha picked up the mantle of Elijah and crossed over Jordan on dry ground. As the Jordan River, which means descender, is a type of death, so the crossing of Jordan on dry ground is a type of the entering into deathless life or immortality. Even so shall the Elisha group wield the powers of immortality as did Jesus when he was on the earth. And as Elijah was taken out and caught up, so shall a part of the man-child company be caught up into the heavenlies to wield the powers of the glorified life during the time of great tribulation on the earth. And as Elijah was divided asunder from Elisha by a chariot of fire, so does this picture the fiery tribulation which shall be encompassing the inhabitants of the earth at that time. But as Elisha saw Elijah go in the whirlwind, so shall the whirlwind of my judgment be upon those who seek to destroy or harm the Elisha group who have been left behind to enter into the powers of the immortal life. And as Elisha did many more works than Elijah, so does this picture the mighty work which shall be done by the manifested sons on the earth during the tribulation days. As Elijah was seen by Elisha as he went, so does this show that those who are taken and who enter into the glorified life will minister and be seen from time to time by those who are left on the earth. Even so shall my plan be fulfilled and my body of overcomers go forth to overcome all the works of the enemy in that day. I would also have you understand that as there was a division at the beginning of the tribulation, so shall there be a division at the close of the tribulation. For the Elijah-Elisha drama has a double fulfillment. Thus at the close of the tribulation of great host will have been prepared to be taken into the heavenlies. For they shall be translated into the heavenlies in that day when I come to gather my saints to myself. But there will be others who are not ready to be taken. Even so shall they be left behind in that day to enter into immortality in human flesh. And having entered into immortality, they shall continue to live in physical bodies throughout the entire millennium. At the close of the millennium, they too shall be taken into the heavenly realms. So do you not see, my people, how I must divide? For by division will I conquer, by separating that which is ready for one realm from that which is ready for another realm. and by deployment of my forces in whatever place and realm that I choose, I am able to overcome the works of the enemy and confound the Ammon caused of the proud, says the Lord. The woman in the wilderness. Is there not coming a time of great tribulation, says the Lord? And am I not preparing a people who shall minister to me during that time? I say, I am preparing a people, and they shall be used mightily in that day when the foundations of the earth do quake and when the foundations of human society are breaking in pieces. For it will be a fearful day, and the hearts of men shall fail as they see the things that are coming. But I will be for a sanctuary and for a covering to those who put their trust in me, Isaiah 8:13-14, and I will shield them from all harm and provide for their needs in that day. And now hear my word concerning that which you read in Revelation chapter 12 concerning the woman in the wilderness. The woman represents that glorious church which I am preparing and which will minister the word of life in power during the tribulation. And the wrath of Satan shall be against her, and the remnant of her seed, which is left on the earth, Revelation 12:15-17. For previously did she give birth, and that which was born was caught up to the throne and glorified, Revelation 12:5, all except a remnant of her seed which was left on the earth to do a mighty work for me, Revelation 12:17. Now what is the difference between the woman and the man-child which comes forth from her bosom? The man-child comes forth as the seed of the woman, and I will use this man-child to bruise the head of the serpent. For the pattern is true and must be fulfilled. The first fulfillment was when the woman Israel gave birth to the man Christ Jesus. For is it not written, You are my son, this day have I begotten thee. Psalms 2:7. And from whom was he begotten? And when was the day of his birth? Was it not when he came forth from the womb of the Virgin Mary? She gave birth to the Son of Man, and he was later glorified as the Son of God. And when was the day of his begettal to glorified life? Was it not when he came forth from the grave? Was not that the day of his birth into the glories of the heavenly? Acts 13:33. And now consider the fulfillment of the pattern even in this end time. Shall I not bring forth from the womb of my glorious church those like to the Son of Man, and shall I not also bring forth those like to the glorified Son of God? For first shall come forth that which is like the Son of Man as a company of my chosen ones enter into immortality in human flesh. This shall be the first fulfillment of the seed of the woman. And then shall come the second fulfillment in this end time when I shall cause a man-child company to be caught up into the heavenlies. This will be their begettal into glorified life, even that life which will fulfill the pattern of the Son of God when he was raised and glorified. Now what would I have you to know concerning the woman? Will she not be made ready, and will she not minister in power in the days of tribulation? Does it not say that I will give her wings of an eagle to carry her to safety during the time that the serpent seeks to destroy her? Revelation 12:14. And what would I have my people know? It is even this. In that day there shall be great danger from Satan-inspired hordes of people who will be whipped to a frenzy by the hate-inspired apostles of the enemy. And they will pour out their venom of hatred on those who are warning of the coming wrath, and those who are preaching a message of repentance in that day. And the life of my people will be in constant danger from those who want to silence the preachers of righteousness, for their deeds are evil and they hate the light and the truth. Therefore my people shall be sensitive to hear my voice that I may protect them and lead them to places of safety. For at times I will awaken them in the night and tell them to move to another location because of the danger that encompasses them. And my angels will be present to direct them where to go, and my glorified ones will appear to them and instruct them as to what they are to do. For it will be a fearful time as chaos reigns in the earth, and as the hate-inspired forces of the enemy seek to destroy those who would warn them and turn them from their evil ways. Those who have entered into immortality in human flesh, even the seed of the woman, shall have greater contact with the unseen world. For they will receive constant guidance and protection from the world beyond, and they shall be able to speak the word of the Lord to all who are in need of direction. For my immortal ones on earth and my glorified ones in the heavens shall be in constant communication with one another, and they shall provide help and guidance to the woman as she ministers in that day. Now I would have you consider the way in which I will have my church meet in that day. I will have you meet in small groups in the places that I will show you. Many times you will have to meet in secret because the authorities will be clamping down on all that they consider fanaticism. So great will be the boldness of my servants in that day, and so astounding will be their message and their works, that the authorities will take action to try to stop the meetings. So my people, you will have to hear my voice and do that which I show you, for I will direct you in all your ways, and I will show you when and where to gather together. Because of the great danger from both the hysterical mobs and the frightened authorities, much pressure will be put on all those who tend to deviate from accepted patterns of behavior and from approved procedures of religious activity. For even the religious world will seek to set up standards in that day of what is acceptable and what is not acceptable to the welfare of the nation in the times of extreme crisis. I say, those who dare to not conform will be considered as fanatics and harmful deviates and will be persecuted relentlessly by those who pose to be the religious voice of the land. So my true servants will be buffeted from all sides as the people who are crazed by fear seek every means available to silence them. The people as a whole will refuse to listen to those who would call them to repentance and warn them of impending judgment in that day. And now consider also the danger that will come from natural disasters and from man-caused eruptions in that day. For there will be many places where disasters shall strike suddenly, and where battles will rage furiously. And were not my people warned, they would surely perish. So I will give warning, says the Lord, to all who are in danger that they may flee to places of safety, that the forces of destruction harm them not. They shall be told where to go to escape, says the Lord. From whence shall come the warnings? I will warn by vision and by appearance of my glorified ones who shall be on constant duty in that day. They shall be empowered to bear my people up if need be and transport them to places of safety, and at times they shall be clothed and fed by supernatural means as they are obedient to my voice and follow the instructions that are given to them. So fear not my people, for I will surely keep you and protect you in that day. For even now all things are being made ready that nothing will be amiss when the great time of tribulation comes on the earth. End of prophecy. Amen and amen. Jesus Christ bless you. Kindly share the word. Fresh number Mungu mpete maneno ya yasiniumize mfanye sugu wewe, yeah. Wakitrai kuntisha